So today we're going to talk about cardiopulmonary exercise testing interpretation for the non-expert. As far as disclosures, I have no financial disclosures to make regarding this topic. However, I would like to disclose that I am not a CPET expert. And in fact, when I sit down in clinic with a report of a CPET, I often end up feeling like this. So when the idea for this topic came up, I accepted the challenge and turned it into a personal learning opportunity and hopefully can help out some other people as well. And what I hope to do with kind of these series of lectures is really boil down a very, very complicated test into basic patterns so that when we're sitting in clinic, you can pick out the salient points and at least do your best to explain what might be going on to the patient who's sitting in front of you. So as Amin mentioned, we decided to split this up into small pieces. So today I'm just gonna do a brief introduction, talk about the metabolic parameters and mention probably the single most important parameter of the cardiopulmonary exercise test, which is the VO2. Next time we'll talk about cardiac parameters and then subsequently the ventilatory and gas exchange parameters. So before we start with the interpretation, I have two recommendations. The first is to find yourself a good pocket reference book. And this happens to be the one that I have. I found it on Amazon. It's small, it's to the point. I keep it in my bag. I have it in clinic. I can reference it when looking at tests. If you're looking to be an expert, it's probably not for you, but if you're looking to just get through it, it's quite helpful. My second piece of advice is always ask the expert. You can, fortunately, here at National Jewish, always find one. One way to do it is if you look on the spiderweb doc for that, there's a PPU attending always listed, and they should be available to review with you if you have any questions. Okay, so let's get started. So what exactly is a CPET? It's a test, you maybe heard about it, multiple names. So cardiopulmonary exercise test, where I did my training, we call it a CPX. Here, if you want to order it, it's called an exercise tolerance test. They're all basically the same. It's essentially an EKG stress test with the addition of pulmonary parameters being measured. And that's done by adding either a mask or a mouthpiece to allow for recording of breath-by-breath analysis of oxygen, carbon dioxide, and other parameters. It can be done either on a cycle ergometer, which is basically a stationary bike or a treadmill, and can be done with or without an arc line. Here at National Jewish, we take it even a few steps further. You've probably seen you can order it with or without continuous laryngoscopy and with and without an invasive pulmonary artery catheter. We're not going to talk about any of those. Okay. So why would we think about getting a CPET? There are a multitude of indications in which you might think a CPET might be helpful. Commonly in a pulmonary clinic, you want to evaluate somebody's exertional dyspnea. And I think that it can be helpful, particularly if they're resting. Studies don't explain what's going on. You can also assess the different contributions of the cardiac or respiratory component to their dyspnea. You can quantify fitness level. Surgical risk stratification is a common reason to obtain it as well. Or you can measure response to intervention, such as diuretics, pulmonary vasodilators, et cetera. In my clinic, again, usually I'm ordering it to evaluate somebody's exertional dyspnea. And when I'm sitting there talking to my patient about why I think this test might be helpful, I usually try to explain that it can help us answer the following questions. We want to know, can you exercise to your predicted exercise capacity? Yes or no? And if no, is it because of your heart, your lungs, or both? So if you order the test and your patient goes for it, what exactly happens? There are four general stages of a CPET test. And it's shown here in this figure. So along the y-axis is time, and along the, the x-axis is time, and the y-axis is workload or energy expenditure against the bike. So the first phase is rest. So the patient's on the bike, they have a mouthpiece in place. They're allowed to let their respiratory pattern normalize, and then data is collected. The second phase is the unloaded cycling phase, in which the patients begin to pedal the bike, but no resistance is yet applied. Again, data is collected. The main third phase of the PET or of the exercise test is the cycling portion, where increasing resistance is added at regular intervals, and the patient is asked to pedal against the increasing resistance with increased workload. And they're asked to keep a particular cadence, and they go until they can't exercise anymore, at which point that would be peak exercise. Then the resistance is let off and they enter the recovery phase, in which they continue to pedal to prevent a drop in blood pressure, but no longer against resistance. So once the test has been completed, a report is generated. And familiarizing yourself with that report can be quite helpful. Unfortunately, it can also be very, very intimidating. The whole report is usually about 60 pages. And it's important to know where you can go to get kind of the most important data quickly and in a certain format. And so I would direct all of our non-experts out there to this page, which comes in the report. And it's usually page 2 or page 3. Here you have, I eliminated the patient's name, but parameters and demographics at the top, all of which, and then the other parameters that are measured during the test, so metabolic, cardiac, ventilatory, and gas exchange, all of the predicted values are listed, and the predicted values are based on height, weight, age, and gender, values at rest, values at maximum work, and then the percent predicted. So this is the same page, I just blew it up a little bit. The first set of parameters are labeled the metabolic parameters, and these are the parameters that are gonna help you answer that first question that you pose to your patient, whether or not they can exercise to their maximum capacity. So these include work, which is the energy expended against the bike, the VO2, which is oxygen uptake, VCO2, which is output of carbon dioxide from the body, and the respiratory exchange ratio. The next box includes, again, all the cardiac parameters, which is heart rate, oxygen pulse, and blood pressure. We'll talk about those next time. And then finally, all of the ventilatory parameters. So this is all usually page 2 or 3 of the 60-page report. The second very important page is this page right here, which is the 9-panel plot page. And again, it's usually page 11 or so on the 60-page report. So it's complicated. There's a lot of overlapping graphs, but this is where you can come to find all of the data that you need. I'm not gonna go through all of the details today, but here at National Jewish, plots 1, 2, and 3 pertain to cardiovascular parameters. Plots 5, 6, and 9 show the ventilatory parameters. And plots 4, 7, and 8 represent the ventilation perfusion relationships. You can keep this as a reference, and we'll go through this more in detail coming up. Okay, so now that we know where to look for the data that we're looking for, let's get started with basic interpretation, looking at the initial parameters. And so the first thing we want to know when somebody completes a CPET is, did they achieve a maximal effort? And this is important because we need to know that the test was a maximal effort in order to derive appropriate conclusions regarding their exercise capacity. There are several ways in which we can determine whether it was a maximal effort given by the patient. Most common is to use a workload, and greater than 80% of their predicted workload would suggest a maximal effort was attained on the test. We can also look at the heart rate greater than 80% or respiratory exchange ratio of greater than 1.15. If we're looking at the work, we need to determine how to find the work on our sheet to determine if it was a maximal test. So work is essentially the energy that the patient spends working against the resistance of the cycle ergometer or the treadmill, depending on what they're on. It's measured in watts, and the predicted workload is calculated based on the patient's height, weight, age, and gender. And we find this parameter on the top left panel, the nine plant panel plot. So right here. And if we zoom in on that plot, so we can see here on along the x-axis is time, and actually along this y-axis is work. Other parameters are also plotted here, but we'll focus on work. And then we can reference that with the metabolic parameters that we saw on the other page. So on this patient in particular, so looking down here, his predicted work was 195 watts. And at his maximum exercise, he hit 265 watts. So he achieved 136% of his predicted workload. So based on this alone, he did give a maximal effort. And now we can look at our main outcomes, knowing that this was a maximal effort, which is the VO2. As I mentioned before, it's probably the single most important parameter on the CPET. It is a representation of the volume of oxygen utilized by the body, and it's calculated by looking at the difference between the inhaled and exhaled oxygen fractions. It's usually expressed in liters per minute, but can also be normalized to weight. The VO2 max, which you hear people reference, is the highest value of the VO2 during the test. And the VO2 versus time is also plotted on the same upper left-hand corner. And in general, greater than 80% predicted is used to define a normal VO2. So in this same patient, we look back at the same plot. And if we blow it up and look at the same parameters, again, this time, again, along the x-axis is time. And over here, along the y-axis is VO2 in green diamonds. So you can follow the VO2, which should linearly increase with the workload, and this patient's did. And down here, so his VO2 predicted max was 2.44 liters per minute. And at max exercise, he hit 3.02. So his VO2 max was 124% of his predicted. So he certainly achieved his predicted exercise capacity based on VO2. And in a situation like this, when you're sitting in front of the patient, you can, for the most part, say that a VO2 max of greater than 80% predicted means that it's unlikely that you have clinically significant pathology affecting your heart or lungs. If we find any other abnormalities, it would be considered non-limiting. And so that's where we'll stop today. You all can stay tuned for parts 2 and 3, where we'll break things down even further. Okay, thanks for having me back, Dr. Sergu. So today we're gonna do part 2 of cardiopulmonary exercise testing interpretation for the non-expert. Again, I have no financial disclosures to make regarding this topic, but again, I would like to disclose, I'm not a CPET expert, but it's been actually really helpful learning in preparation for these presentations. And again, remember, if this is you, when you look at a CPET report, then these slides are for you. So last time in part 1, we introduced the basics of cardiopulmonary exercise testing and addressed a few of the metabolic parameters, including the VO2, which is the single most important parameter measured on a cardiopulmonary exercise test. Today in part 2, we'll focus on cardiac parameters, and then next time we'll finish up with ventilatory and gas exchange assessment. And to give everybody a quick refresher, this is the comprehensive report that we get that's generated here at National Jewish. And as it says, it's usually page 2 of that big 60-page report that we get. It contains patient demographics at the top, and then a breakdown of all the reported parameters, including predicted parameters, parameters at rest, at maximum workload for review. And again, if you remember, last time we looked at the first box here in red, which includes the metabolic parameters, including the VO2, which represents oxygen uptake by the body and is calculated by the difference between inhaled and exhaled oxygen fractions measured on a breath-by-breath basis. And this is the same data we looked at last time on a patient, where you can see here his predicted VO2 max was 2.44 liters per minute. And at his maximum workload, he achieved greater than that of 3.02 liters per minute. So he hit 124% of his predicted VO2 max, which is normal exercise capacity. Today, we're going to take a closer look at the cardiac parameters, which are outlined here in green. These include heart rate, oxygen pulse, and systemic blood pressure. And again, this is kind of a comprehensive graphical representation of a lot of the data that comes out of the exercise study. And on the 9-panel plot here, cardiovascular parameters are usually contained in plots 1, 2, and 3. This is specific here to National Jewish. But for simplicity's sake, the parameters we're going to talk about today are, we'll focus mostly on plot 2. We'll go through that. So the first parameter we'll look at is heart rate. So in a healthy subject, heart rate should steadily rise with exercise workload throughout exercise. And a healthy subject should be able to achieve at least greater than 80% of their predicted heart rate. And oftentimes we see them hit much closer to 100%. And the equation to calculate somebody's predicted maximum heart rate, which is probably familiar to most of you, is 220 minus their age in years. So when we look at the heart rate on an exercise test, several patterns can emerge. So the first one, of course, if they achieve a greater than 80% predicted heart rate in the setting of a normal VO2 max, this is considered a normal response to exercise. The second pattern that we could see is the subject reaches greater than 80% of their predicted heart rate, but in the setting of a low VO2 max. In this situation, it's likely representative of some sort of cardiac dysfunction, meaning that these patients, they'll max out their heart rate because their only means of increasing their cardiac output is through their heart rate if they have LV or RV dysfunction. And oftentimes the pattern that will be seen on the test is that they'll max out their heart rate very quickly. Finally, you can see a heart rate less than 80% predicted. This is known as a high heart rate reserve. And in the setting of a low VO2 max, this can suggest several things. One, including suboptimal or submaximal effort by the patient. And if you remember last time, we talked about that heart rate can be one of the parameters to look at to determine if a maximal study was achieved. It could also represent chronotropic insufficiency. And usually, again, the pattern graphically represented with this is little, if any, escalation of the heart rate at all. So it will look different. It's often due to medications such as beta blockers. Or finally, a high heart rate reserve or a subject hitting less than 80% of their predicted heart rate could mean that they have pulmonary disease, or essentially that the test was limited by something else before they were able to max out their heart rate. So again, the heart rate is found on plot 2, which is in the center on the top seen here. And so heart rate is on the y-axis on the right side, plotted in red against time on the x-axis. And if we take a closer look, you can see, again, heart rate on the y-axis with time along the bottom. And as exercise progresses, heart rate should linearly increase all the way up to the predicted values, which is the red dotted line. And then you can cross-reference the graph with the report that's on usually page 2. So again, in this patient who happens to be 57 years old, his predicted maximum heart rate was 163. At rest, he's 75 beats per minute. At maximum work, he was 164 beats per minute. So he achieved 100% of his predicted heart rate, which would be a normal response to exercise. The second cardiac parameter that we'll talk about is oxygen pulse, or O2 pulse, you'll hear it referred to as. So it's defined as the amount of oxygen taken up by the lungs into the blood with each heartbeat. And it's calculated by dividing the VO2 by your heart rate, and is essentially an indirect indicator of stroke volume. So knowing this, heart rate times your O2 pulse, or essentially stroke volume, is generally considered equal to your cardiac output. Oxygen pulse usually increases in exercise, more so at first, and then tails off as stroke volume is maxed, and further increases in heart rate are due to increases in cardiac output are due to increasing heart rate. Normal is again considered greater than 80% predicted, and usually equates to more than 10 milliliters per beat at max exercise. If you see a low or a flat oxygen pulse, particularly in the setting of a low VO2 max, heart disease should be suspected. So just like heart rate, the oxygen pulse is plotted here on plot 2 in the top center. This time it's the right-handed blue y-axis with time across the bottom. And again, taking a closer look, you can see the blue dots representing the O2 pulse escalate appropriately throughout the study. First at a greater rate from about minutes 6 to 14 or so, and then slowing down a bit as we would expect as they approach the end of exercise. And again, this patient's O2 pulse is normal with a predicted O2 pulse of 15 milliliters per beat, and he achieved 18, so he achieved more than his predicted. The third parameter that's important to watch is systemic blood pressure, which is measured periodically throughout the test. It's actually not found on the 9-panel plot, but the appropriate response to exercise is that your blood pressure should progressively rise. And if you see a fall at maximum exertion, then definitely worry about myocardial ischemia. Each lab has different parameters of when they consider it hypertensive with exercise. Here, I believe it's 200 over 90 is where it's considered abnormal. And so you can see in this patient, his resting blood pressure was 140 over 82, so elevated. And then certainly he had elevated blood pressure at maximal exertion too, with a blood pressure of 132 over 96. Finally, when thinking about cardiac parameters in a cardiopulmonary exercise test, we need to remember that the patient's wearing EKG leads and has a continuous EKG monitored throughout the entire study and is reviewed upon conclusion of the study. And again, certain things make you worry about cardiac ischemia, and I've listed them here. They're, as you would expect, ST depression, T-wave inversion, new bundle branch blocks, other arrhythmias, certainly worry about cardiac limitations. So when we put this all together and sit down in front of our patient with at least the cardiac parameters that we reviewed today, I often try to summarize and make it simple, say something like, good news, your heart rate, forward blood flow indicating O2 pulse and heart rhythm responded just as they should to exercise. However, your blood pressure did rise higher than we would like and probably should be addressed. So everybody stay tuned. We have one more part. We'll review ventilatory and gas exchange parameters and assessment next time. Thanks.
Thanks. Okay, so today is the day we've all been waiting for, part 3 of 3 for cardiopulmonary exercise test interpretation for the non-expert. And hold on.
So use the actual screen, and there's a little advanced button. Perfect.
Yeah, did we get that? Okay. So again, no new disclosures today. And again, if there's still confusion regarding CPET reports, this is for you. We've already covered parts one and two, and today we'll discuss part three, ventilatory parameters and assessment. This section is a bit longer, so we're going to focus just on a few key parts that are clinically relevant. Again, to quickly review, in part one, we discussed the metabolic parameters, including the VO2, which represents oxygen uptake by the body, and is the difference between inhaled and exhaled oxygen fractions measured on a breath-by-breath basis throughout exercise. Then in part two, we looked at cardiac parameters, which include heart rate, oxygen pulse, which is essentially a surrogate for stroke volume, and blood pressure. Today, we're going to take a look at a few ventilation and perfusion parameters that are seen outlined here in blue. Like I said, this section is a bit longer, and so we're just going to focus on a few important ones that you'll see commonly in your clinic. So we'll discuss five ventilatory parameters today, and they include minute ventilation and respiratory reserve volume, dead space to tidal volume ratio, anaerobic threshold, dynamic hyperinflation, and inefficient ventilation. The first is minute ventilation. As you're likely aware, minute ventilation, denoted here as VE, equals respiratory rate times tidal volume. And in exercise, in a healthy subject, tidal volume can increase about 3 to 5-fold from resting, and respiratory rate should increase more than double. Predicted minute ventilation at maximum exercise is determined by the maximum voluntary ventilation, or MVV. The MVV can be calculated or measured. The calculated MVV is the patient's resting FEV1 times 40. The measured MVV is obtained through a maneuver in which the patient is instructed to breathe on a mouthpiece in and out as fast as they can for at least 10 seconds. This measured MVV can be found on the spirometry report, which comes along in the CPET report and is done prior to the beginning of the test. So here is our sample patient's resting spirometry, so done the same day as their CPET test, and his measured MVV is 178 liters per minute. In order to obtain a calculated MVV, you have to utilize the patient's resting FEV1 and multiply it by 40, seen here, which would be about 165 liters per minute. So they're not equal, but they're similar. Once you determine the predicted minute ventilation at maximum exercise based on the MVV, there are a few things to remember. The minute ventilation should remain less than 80% predicted at max exercise. This is normal. So a normal subject should have plenty of ventilatory reserve. And if the VE does reach greater than 80%, then likely lung pathology is present. You should note at this point that this is opposite of several of the cardiac parameters that we discussed last time, such as heart rate and oxygen pulse, in which a healthy subject should max out those parameters. Additionally, from a clinical perspective, a CPET rarely reveals significant lung disease that's not already known prior to the test. So here, if we look at our patient's minute ventilation, he achieves a minute ventilation of 114 liters per minute at maximum exercise. So that's what he actually did during the test. And then we want to know, does he have adequate ventilatory reserve? His maximum minute ventilation is divided by his measured MVV, which was 178 liters per minute, if you remember. And it shows that he achieved 68% of his measured MVV. So he has adequate ventilatory reserve because it's less than 80%. You can also double check all of this with a calculated MVV, which again is the FEV 1 times 40, which was 165 liters per minute. And by that calculation, he achieved 69%. So here, by either method, we see that this patient has plenty of ventilatory reserve. So now you can sit down and say to your patient, good news, you have plenty of ventilatory reserve, even at maximum exercise. If that number were at or greater than 80%, we would be worried that your lungs may be limiting your ability to exercise. The second parameter we'll discuss today is the dead space tidal volume ratio, or the VDVT ratio. So this is a useful indicator of how well ventilation is matched to perfusion within the lungs during exercise. Remember, there are two types of dead space that we need to be aware of. Anatomic, which is the volume of gas that does not participate in gas exchange, essentially the amount of gas that stays stuck or stays in the conducting airways, and physiologic, which is due to unperfused or underperfused alveoli. In exercise, the VDVT should decrease because physiologic dead space goes down, is due to increased blood flow, and the tidal volume increases. So the dead space that remains is a smaller percentage of the total tidal volume. Normal VDVT is about 0.4 and should decline to around 0.2 in exercise. An elevated VDVT ratio at rest, or one that does not decline with exercise, suggests either primary pulmonary vascular disease or pulmonary vascular disease that may be due to intrinsic lung disease. And here, looking at our patient's VDVT, both measured and estimated, start lower than we would expect, around 0.2, but both decline with exercise, which would be considered a normal response. Next, we'll move on to anaerobic threshold. So this is an important parameter that marks the point in exercise when anaerobic metabolism supplements aerobic metabolism to continue exercise or work, because beyond that point, circulating oxygen carrying capacity can't meet the metabolic demands. Anaerobic metabolism is characterized by generation of lactate, which is buffered by bicarbonate, and ultimately leads to increased CO2 production. Anaerobic threshold should occur when the VO2 is at least 40% of its predicted maximum. Some trained athletes have an anaerobic threshold closer to 80% of their VO2 max. Because anaerobic threshold is determined by oxygen delivery to the muscles, the main drivers of a low anaerobic threshold include a low cardiac output and low peripheral oxygen saturation. There are multiple ways to determine the anaerobic threshold. Most common is probably this one, the V-slope method. This is done by utilizing the graph with VO2 on the x-axis plotted against VCO2 on the y-axis. The anaerobic threshold is the point, the inflection point, at which the slope of the line changes. So this indicates the point at which beyond this, the VO2 is increasing at a faster rate than the VO2 due to the production of lactate and therefore increased carbon dioxide. Now, this particular plot on our NJ reports is not found directly on the 9-panel page that I've showed you before, but it can be found in the report on one of the smaller plots. This patient here, our sample patient, his anaerobic threshold, again at the inflection point where the two lines meet, appears to be around 65 or 70% of his VO2 max, and again would be considered normal. There are other methods to determine or double check the anaerobic threshold. I'm not going to discuss them all, but you can refer back to this as reference. The first one listed, the V-slope method, is the one that we discussed on the previous slide. Next, let's talk about dynamic hyperinflation. I feel like I see this pretty commonly in my pulmonary clinic. This is an exercise phenomenon in patients with obstructive lung disease, usually moderate or severe. And I think it's important that we keep this on our radar because it's associated with significant dyspnea and work of breathing and can really drive exercise intolerance. Patients with obstructive lung disease, as we know, are dependent on a prolonged expiratory phase of respiration. When they start to exercise, their expiratory time shortens, and consequently, they suffer an increase in end expiratory lung volume. So there's more left in the lungs at the end of their exhalation, and therefore a decrease in their inspiratory capacity. The only means in which they have left to increase their minute ventilation during exercise is to increase their respiratory rate and take much smaller tidal volumes. So they literally develop a rapid, shallow breathing pattern on top of hyperinflated lungs. In order to determine if dynamic hyperinflation is present, we need to look at the inspiratory capacity trend on the flow loops from the exercise study. So the inspiratory capacity is defined as the maximum amount of air that can be inspired after reaching the end of a normal quiet expiration and equals tidal volume plus inspiratory reserve volume. Generally, a 350 milliliter drop or a 15% decline in inspiratory capacity throughout exercise is considered a significant change and is an indication that hyperinflation is probably occurring. If present, the clinician should address causes of airway inflammation, weight loss, and consider speech therapy to address respiratory rate recruitment during exercise. So this is what the flow loop trend on the report looks like. The top left red loop is the resting maximal flow loop. And then as exercise starts and progresses, the tidal volume loops are recorded at regular intervals and are seen here in multiple colors overlaid on the maximal loop. The inspiratory capacity, seen here, is measured from end expiratory lung volume to the total lung capacity, which is right where the X and the Y axis meet there on the left-hand side. And so what you wanna see, or what would be a normal response, would be stability of the end expiratory lung volume and the inspiratory capacity volume. If it drops, if the inspiratory capacity drops or shifts towards the left, dynamic hyperinflation is occurring. And if we look back on the left side of the serial plots, this patient's inspiratory capacity is stable throughout exercise without evidence of dynamic hyperinflation. And I tried to denote that with some of those green brackets. So the last concept we'll discuss today is inefficient ventilation. I think we see it fairly commonly on the physician read reports, and I often wonder what it really means. So inefficient ventilation is a concept based on a drive parameter called ventilatory equivalence. There's a ventilatory equivalent for oxygen and a ventilatory equivalent for carbon dioxide. Since we're talking about ventilation, the efficiency is based on the ventilatory equivalent for carbon dioxide. The ventilatory equivalent for carbon dioxide is essentially minute ventilation divided by amount of carbon dioxide expelled, or to think about it more simply, how many milliliters of air went in and out of the lungs to get 1 milliliter of carbon dioxide out. If less air is needed, the lungs are more efficient, and therefore lower is better. And when they're more efficient, it's usually due to improved VQ mismatch due to homogeneous blood flow through the lungs through exercise, during exercise. So during exercise, the ventilatory equivalent for carbon dioxide should fall. And when it's at its nadir, that indicates the lungs are functioning at their most efficient. If the ventilatory equivalent for carbon dioxide does not drop to a certain level, some resources utilize a cutoff of 30. Here at NJ, I think they use a cutoff of 34. Inefficient ventilation is present. Since it's a derived parameter, when inefficient ventilation is seen, there should be some other clues in the test data indicating whether it's primarily driven by cardiac or pulmonary abnormalities. Perhaps the most clinically relevant part of this parameter is that a high ventilatory equivalent for carbon dioxide carries a poor prognosis in heart failure. And so they probably use it pretty regularly in the cardiac clinic. You can look for inefficient ventilation on plot 4 of the NJ9 panel plot. And so that's this is plot 4. And on the left-hand y-axis in green is the ventilatory equivalents for carbon dioxide. And on the y-axis in blue on the right side is ventilatory equivalent for oxygen. Both are plotted against time on the x-axis. And if we focus on the green, we look for the lowest point or the spot at which the lungs are most efficient at expelling carbon dioxide. It's probably around the 14-minute mark with the red arrow and appears to be around 30 or 32 or so. Here at NJ, this would be considered normal, and that's how this test was read. So these were the five parameters that we discussed today. I think they're all clinically important and can help determine causes of dyspnea in your patient. In our sample patient, he happened to show normal findings on all of them. So since we've hit the high points from beginning to end, now's the time to practice. I recommend finding a good pocket reference. This is the one that I like and I keep with me and use to prepare this among other things. And then always feel free to ask the expert. You can find the PPU attending on call on doc for that, and they're happy to answer questions as well. So there you have it, the end. Thanks for your attention. It's been fun.